Assalamualaikum, bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. And a very good afternoon, especially to our Honourable Secretary General of Ministry of Transport Malaysia, Dato' Isham, the CLTM newly elected President, Datuk Muhammad Muhiyuddin, Haji Abdullah, to all panel participants, and of course, for those who are really willing to spend time with us today lah in the webinar session. I do understand that we have about 400 numbers of participants who have registered with us to attend this webinar from national and also international. I would like to welcome everyone again to webinar that is basically organized by partnership of CILT Malaysia, MITRANS UITM Shah Alam, and Port Klang Authority. And the topic of discussion on this webinar today entitled An Awareness on Shipping Dangerous Goods by Sea. Okay, and I would like to introduce myself first to all participants and also, of course, panel semua, we do have introduction before this. I'm Siti Zaharah Ishak from MITRANS and I will be moderating this live webinar session today. Before we begin, I have a few housekeeping notes that today's session is being recorded to be available for viewing post-webinar. And if you have any questions for the presenters, please use the chat features in the Zoom webinar so that I can pose a question later to the presenters to answer during Q&A session. But during opening, we are not having Q&A. I mean, like, we are not accepting still, yeah? And the questions, but we reserve the question during the Q&A session. Okay, for a tentative schedule, we are going to start with the opening remark from our Honourable Secretary General, Ministry of Transport, Yang Berbahagia Dato' Isham Ishak, followed by panel discussion by four panelists, the expert, of course, from various transport and logistic field, in particularly on shipping goods by sea. Okay, I will do the introduction of each panelist before the beginning of their session. And each presenter today will have 15 minutes for their presentation and we followed by Q&A. Okay, without further ado, I would like to welcome the Honourable Yang Berbahagia Dato' Isham Ishak, the Secretary General, Ministry of Transport Malaysia, to deliver his welcome remarks. Silakan, Dato'.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Very good afternoon. Let me first acknowledge Yang Bahagia Datuk Muhammad Muhiyuddin Haji Abdullah, the President of the Chartered Institute of Logistics and Transport Malaysia, or CILTM. And I don't think we can do well in our webinar today without our Honourable Moderator, Dr. Siti Zaharah Ishak, Deputy Director of the Malaysia Institute of Transport, MITRANS University Technology Mara UITM. And I wish to also acknowledge the panel of speakers, Ms. Reshma Yousuf, the Dangerous and Good Safety Advisor, and whom I was made to understand was a very important person in trying to bring the right people for this webinar. Thank you very much, Ms. Reshma. We have Mr. Alvin Chua, President of the Federation of Malaysian Freight Forwarders, Mr. Nubhan Basarudin, Manager, Dangerous Goods, Port Klang Authority. I would also like to acknowledge the role of the Port Klang Authority for the in organizing the webinar today. Then we have Captain Kenneth Koo, who's also the President of the Malaysia Maritime Education and Training Association. And also I would also like to acknowledge the members, both local and also those participating from overseas. A very warm welcome to everyone. And thank you for participating in this webinar and awareness of shipping dangerous goods by sea. Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to thank CILTM, MITRANS, UITM, and also the Port Klang Authority for inviting me to officiate this very, very timely webinar for our shipping community. Ladies and gentlemen, the shipping of dangerous goods in containers today makes up about 20% of world trade. Apart from general cargo, our cargo ships also carry a significant amount of various types of dangerous goods. Handling these goods poses a challenge to the safety of the lives of the crew and transport workers, as well as the environment, especially when these goods have not been declared, documented, packaged, communicated to the respective parties. These are the challenges that today we are facing. And when these are not communicated to us or not declared, and the dangerous goods become even more dangerous because we are unaware and unprepared to actually handle those goods. And it does not only affect the hard assets at the port, including the ships, but the soft assets, the people on the ground who are handling these goods. We have seen from the current COVID-19 pandemic, which has hit the shipping industries both in areas concerning health and safety of workers in the transport supply chain and the ongoing space and container demand imbalance. In the midst of safely and consistently managing the flow of global trade during this pandemic, the ships have been exploding. We've seen ships exploding and causing loss of lives, property, and worse yet, damaging the marine environment. This to me is something that is very alarming, and we have to really open our eyes, not only the industry players, but also government authorities who are handling dangerous goods. Ladies and gentlemen, from the year 2019 through 2020, and quite recently this year in 2021, we have seen multiple incidences involving explosions of container ships. In 2020, we saw the MV Wakasho leak hundreds of tons of fuel off the Mauritius coast. And most recently, in 2021, the devastation to the Sri Lankan coast by the ship Express Pearl. We've seen it on TV, and we've seen the devastation that it has impacted the community and to those countries who are very close by to those ships who have actually exploded. So this is something is of concern to governments. This goes to show how shipping of dangerous goods could result in damages to our environment if we do not undertake serious actions in improving our handling of dangerous goods. Now, ladies and gentlemen, being a government employee or government authority, we should not just put the blame on those community players, but government must also be involved to ensure the continuous safety of the movement of dangerous goods. My concern is with regards to the current situation. Governments today are more or focused or have their hands full in managing the health crisis, the pandemic. So many of our resources, the government resources, are focused or put to help in vaccinating the community or the people of countries and trying to get in vaccines, trying to establish vaccination centers, managing those who are sick due to the COVID-19. So the concern here is the resources and the focus of government are more towards health and public health. But what about dangerous goods? So when governments announce lockdowns, when government announces that their employees should be working from home, this causes concern to me, especially because governments must be ready and must be vigilant with the handling of dangerous goods. So we must ensure that the relationship between the industry and the government must continue to communicate and to talk to each other and ensuring that the management of dangerous of goods are being put into focus and becomes priority. Ladies and gentlemen, the world economy is a very volatile state. Adding to this burden is the constant threat of climate change. I strongly believe everybody on this planet, especially the industry players, are aware of the consequences of our actions, be it individually, and especially collectively with regards to protecting our environment. This is where the topic of this webinar is relatively or rather timely, where the panel of speakers today will provide a picture of what is involved when dangerous and hazardous goods move along the global supply chains. How these goods have the potential of not only harming lives of people, but also its potential of harming the environment. This webinar today will provide the proper guidelines and rules that need to be complied to ensure that these goods move safely and seamlessly. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope that the participants in this seminar will be able to benefit from the exchange of views and knowledge and to help the industry further understand what is at stake, the challenges that we face, whether the current rules, laws, and regulations are sufficient to ensure that the industry continues to operate in a safe and condition. And but last but not least, I would also like to welcome suggestions from the participants on whether the current rules, regulations are sufficient enough and whether the government can do much better in introducing much better rules or improving the current rules so that the industry continue to operate in a very safe environment. I hope that all 200 participants today will not only enjoy the discourse on the topic of awareness of shipping of dangerous goods by sea, but I hope that you will enjoy the exchanges of information and also ensure that the community within the supply chain that is handling the movement of dangerous goods continue to update each other and also ensure that we continue to operate in a very safe environment. With that, I would like to wish everyone a very successful webinar today on the topic and hopefully that the governments can be advised by the industry on any new suggestions or recommendations that the government can take to continue to help the community. With that, I thank you for your time and I wish everyone the best in this webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Isham, for very insightful notes. And I believe there are lots of challenges related with the shipping industry that we are faced today, and Dato also did highlighted a few cases that was happened. And for us, it is very important for industry and ministry to work together in order to cater for this issue so that this can help in terms of the shipping industry in Malaysia. Thank you very much, Dato, once again, for all the important notes and also for your time joining us today. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dato. All right, so without further ado, now let us proceed with our webinar, okay? With our first panel that is on board with us today is Ma'am Reshma Yousuf, yeah? So let me introduce Ma'am Reshma, basically a founder, key consultant and trainer of CLLB. And she has more than 20 years experience in this integrated logistic industry as a service provider, user, trainer, and also consultant. She is a charter member of the Chartered Institute of Logistic and Transport, CILT, and has also obtained corporate affiliation between CLLB and CILT. She currently is the council member of CILT. Reshma has been actively involved in Malaysian Logistic Council, MLC, in the focus group on integrated logistics and supply chain. She was instrumental in providing studies and report in gap found within the human resource development in logistics sector in Malaysia. And she has initiated the focus on dangerous goods, DG safety and security compliance during her involvement in MLC and is actively working towards industry-based SAF compliance in the movement, storage and handling of DG. She has also attended the subcommittee meeting related to the revisions and update of the International Maritime Dangerous Goods IMDG code developed by the International Maritime Organization, IMO, the specialized agency of UN. Yeah? And she conduct training throughout Peninsula and East Asia and has facilitated a number of these training programs. And in her capacity, she has also offered consultancy services pertaining to safe and secure handling and transport of dangerous goods. Okay, without further ado, with this very vast knowledge in this, I would like to welcome and pass the floor to you, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Puan Zaharah. Assalamualaikum, everyone. Good day. Thank you very much, Yang Bahagia, Dato' Isham Ishak. So, spot on, you gave us a wonderful speech just now. And it's so nice to see how inclusive you are and how ready you are to hear from what the industry has to come back to you in terms of how we can improve in this. Thank you so much. Also, Dato' Muhiyuddin, our brand new president of CILT Malaysia, and of course, our respected panel members. Allow me to share my screen. Just give me a second while I put it on. Okay. So, 10 years ago, if somebody had actually come out and told me that, you know, Reshma, one day you're going to speak about your passion on protecting the planet in a DG webinar, in a dangerous goods webinar, I'd have laughed at them, honestly. But that's exactly what I plan to do today. I'm going to take you through, yeah, of course, a bunch of provisions and guidelines pertaining to how do we safely manage dangerous goods. But also what I'm going to do is I'm going to help in whatever I can in this short period of time to connect it to how we can follow these compliance regulations to fulfill the United Nations Sustainability Development Goals. All right, so we start the story with dangerous goods. And we start with asking a few questions. For instance, what are these dangerous or hazardous goods? And why do we call them dangerous in the first place? And if they're so dangerous, then why do we need them? And since for some reason we need them, how do these goods actually move most of the time from the seller to the buyer? And when they do move, who are the parties who are responsible in ensuring that they are safely handled and they are transported in the entire transport chain? And how do we then, what are there? That means what are the tools that have been developed that are available in terms of guiding the parties in the transport chain to ensure that these goods move safely? And finally, I will end my presentation by connecting those dots. That means how does this now relate to your sustainability development goals? Because now it's really a climate crisis we are going through. So I'm going to urge to you, share my passion. I love the IMDG code and all these regulations, but I want to share that passion with all of you. And I want you to see that this can also, of course, it's a corporate social responsibility, but this can also be a personal responsibility, something that we can individually do for the planet. Right. So what are dangerous goods? So when we start with, you know, the formal definitions of dangerous goods, you'll always get this. You'll always get this information that it's a substance, you know, it's a bunch of substances, which are generally chemicals, yeah, and articles, yeah. And these substances and articles, the reason why we say they are so dangerous, because they have these potentials. Look what they do to us, yeah. They have the potential of hurting us in multiple ways. I have very close family that has been affected by this, so you can understand where I'm coming from. It also has the potential of destroying property. And I think last year, all of us saw, amidst the whole pandemic, the whole crisis of the pandemic, we saw what happened in Beirut, right? And that was devastating. But one of the worst things that these goods have a potential of doing is damaging the environment. Because when it damages the environment, it's not like a short-term damage, you know? Some of these damages can stay on for decades. So let's understand a little bit more about this. So since it is so dangerous, right? It has all those potentials of doing all those weird stuff to us. why do we then need this? I mean, so dangerous, let's not move it. Here we're concerned about the climate, protecting the planet, saving lives, but yet we need this stuff. And why do we need it? Well, that's simply because, guess what? We've pretty much depleted natural resources. We've depleted it to the point where we are totally dependent now to manage our modern lives because we're used to so many things with chemical substitutes. And these chemical substitutes have now come in to help us out so we can go on living our lives and in fact making it even more luxurious, can I say? All right, so we have pretty much depleted these natural resources. So in order to continue our livelihoods and our lives, we have to move this cargo. The chemical substitutes have to move, and a lot of them are essential parts of the manufacturing process. So let's like explore some of the areas where we see these chemicals. Okay, they're virtually everywhere. And you'll be shocked, some of you, if you're not sure yet. Now, some are in our food. So like, you know, the fancy flavoring, the things that kind of looks like a banana, but is not a banana, smells like a banana. Well, in our food chain, from insecticides, to pesticides, even to genetically modified organisms, in our homes, from cleaners to disinfectants, remember sanitizer, that's like part of our lives now. And you can see my grays or hair dyes too, hair products, fragrances. And of course, in our medical care, we use them for x-rays and a lot of our clinical stuff, yeah, are also considered dangerous goods. So it's virtually everywhere. They're all part of us. So it's not like we can do without them. It's part of our life. So let's now explore how these goods move. So when we look at how these products, these dangerous goods move, let's look at the two main mode connectors for international transport, yeah? The two main mode connectors would be air transport and ocean sea transport. So when it comes to dangerous goods, and when we talk about air transport, there are a bunch of limitations simply because there's zero tolerance for mistakes. You can't have a tiny thing happening on an aircraft because that aircraft is going to come crashing down. So whatever DG that moves up by air, most of these are generally limited in their sense in terms of the types of classes of dangerous goods and even in terms of their volumes. And quite recently, we've had a lot of instances and incidences with lithium batteries. Now there are a lot of airliners that are now rejecting lithium batteries to be airlifted as well. So where does all these goods go? Guess where? The ocean. Yeah, everything. The ocean takes everything. Everything goes on the ocean. And remember in the definition I told you, the definition for dangerous goods begins with, it is substances and articles. So these substances, they're generally chemicals, right? Now, this is the large quantity that moves by sea. Why? Value-wise, they're lower value, and they are part of a manufacturing process. So they go in large, large volumes in our ocean carriers. And guess what? They're dangerous, right? So when they move in large volumes, what do you think happens? You get large scale disasters and devastation. And these disasters and devastation just doesn't happen in sea. I mean, I pity the crew. My dad used to be a captain too. So, you know, it kind of hurts. You don't want the poor crew to have to suffer just because of certain negligence. But what about our marine life? It's kind of scary if you've watched a few documentaries to see what's happening there. So this large quantities of dangerous goods now, if they're not properly managed meaning that there are certain schemes, certain tools that need to be incorporated, they're going to cause some pretty massive disasters around. So let's look at some of the hazards, right, that you would see in a sea transportation that's carrying dangerous goods. Here's the list. I'm not going to read the list. You can read them. It's showing on the screen. And these are some disaster stories that I'm sharing. I'm so happy to see that our KSU has also shared a couple of stories as well, some pretty scary ones that have occurred. Now, this happened in 2019. And the crazy thing about 2019, in that year, in the very first quarter, I think we witnessed about 4 to 5 explosions on container ships. So on the 3rd of January, you had the Yantian Express. On 29th, you had Olga Merz. And on the 31st, you had APL Vancouver. On February 13, you had ER Kobe. And here's a list from the Drury Shipping Consultants in London. It gives you a list of, you know, the number of ships that have pretty much caught fire. And last year, of course, the Beirut explosion. Yeah, we all know. I think ammonium nitrate became very popular when this happened. And still, there's a lot of problem with this product that we need to really understand and communicate in terms of its safety implications. And yes, this Express Pearl. Now, this is really sad, right? Like, if any of you were following the case, there were a bunch of drums with nitric acid in them. Apparently, they were leaking. They were supposed to be offloaded and worked. You know, let's not go into that. The bottom line is, how did they leak out of their receptacles? What kind of receptacles were used that they were not able to withstand the journey? And when they leaked, and there were other things on that ship, so it reacted with certain other dangerous goods and normal goods. Some goods, even our non-DG goods, are combustible. So they would then add into, I would say, the big party of explosions and cause even worse. Now, I read in one report that the coast of Sri Lanka, the marine life, right? Now, you can't eat. My mom's, I'm born in Sri Lanka as well, I'm Malaysian, but my mom is also from Sri Lanka. And she wants to head back after this whole COVID thing kind of calms down and we're able to travel. I had to warn her, no eating fish, because apparently you can't consume fish for the next 20, 30 years here. So it's kind of sad because these are livelihoods of people, you know, the fishing folk, the fishermen, there goes their livelihoods. Add that to the pandemic, which also pretty much affects your livelihoods. And we all know that, right? So who then who's the party that's responsible in this? We need them, we know they're dangerous, we know what they do to us. We know we have to use, we have to move these things because they're required. So who's then the responsible party? So they're actually in a global transport chain. There are so many parties in that chain, so many various levels where the goods move along. Now, I'm not gonna touch all of the other players. I'm going to focus on where the DG originates, meaning the shipper. I'm going to look at the shipper who is generally, I'm going to take that as the shipper is the manufacturer of the goods. And the shipper, in all the international guidelines that we have, in all of them, be it road, rail, air, or sea, all of them would start with the shipper's responsibility, because it is only the shipper or the manufacturer that knows what they created. And since they know what they have created that has an economical value outside, that means there are people who are willing to buy them, then it becomes their duty to communicate this information. So how do they go about doing that, right? Now, a shipper has to do this. This is the bunch of responsibilities of the shipper. First, identify the substance. How do you identify? You don't just go to a lab and then go about doing it. There are procedures that United Nations have actually developed. There are international guidelines that have been amplified in our local laws as well, where we assist, where these guidelines assist the manufacturer on the test procedures that need to be applied depending if the chemical is solid, liquid, or gas. And then to classify it, because they've come up with the classification systems, which other panel members on our session today will describe each of them. I won't go there. So classify them, communicate them using the safety data sheet, yeah, and package them. So packaging is also a very important thing when it comes to dangerous goods. Now, these goods, especially the chemicals, yeah, we have all these properties. They're corrosive, they're toxic, they're infectious, they're poisonous, they're radioactive, they're generally unstable, all right? Volatile, unstable things. So these volatile, unstable things must be packaged very well. And when we say very well, we can't just use words, right? We need to quantify them. So how do we quantify them? Now, here again comes the UN guidelines, and there are UN guidelines that prescribe, okay, for this kind of DG, you have to use these kind of packagings. And when you use these kind of packagings, they have to be built in this kind of manner. And when they've been built in this manner, before you use them, hold on, send them for a performance test. So packages have to have this UN packing approval mark, and before the goods are dispatched out of the shipper's premise, they have to be properly marked and labeled so that everybody in the transport chain knows that, hey, you know what, this thing is dangerous and we've got to treat it differently. And when they are packed into a transport unit, like a container, then these containers also have to communicate, right? So we stick these big, huge labels, we call them placards. So we warn everybody, here you go, you see these scary, colorful labels telling you that there's something dangerous in there. And we have to declare, because the carrier, and I'm going to leave my panel member, Captain Kenneth, to explain this to you, the carrier generally doesn't know what the shipper packs in the container. So we have to communicate these things to the carrier so that the carrier can then plan when they accept the goods, where they're going to place the goods. So how does the shipper do this? What are these guidelines? Okay. So one of the main guidelines that the shipper starts with in the classification, the identification classification process, is called the GHS. We also call it the Purple Book, the Global Harmonized System from UNCED. Now, this is, now the rules within the GHS is actually amplified in our own document. We've got a DOSH document on industry code of practices for manufacturers to test the substance and to, you know, classify them and communicate them. Then when it comes for transport, we've got a Malaysian standard that amplifies the UN Committee of Experts on the recommendations on transport of dangerous goods. So these MS standards actually are amplifying what's in here pertaining to the packaging and the transport of these dangerous goods. Yeah, so in this book actually compiles a bunch of the different types of modes, because there are two volumes in this, but anyway, this is not a DG class and I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to take you through. All right. So for the transport now this becomes the shipper's responsibility to ensure the first and foremost, your DG must be compliant to the mode, because there are certain dangerous goods that can't go in different modes of transport. Right. And so you must ensure that the right code is used for the right mode. So we're talking about sea transport. The code that we use for sea transport is the IMDG, International Maritime Dangerous Goods Code. And this code gets updated every 2 years. Yeah, for air, it's the IATA DGR. And for rail, this is the RID. And for road, it's called ADR. Now, when it comes to the main modes, air and sea, now, internationally, the air and sea code regimes, the guidelines, these provisions, now, it's good because we've got NCAs, National Competent Authorities, that actually are the communicators, parties in between with the international UN agencies and our local authorities here. And they regulate these rules. And then we have enforcers. So for ocean, the enforcers are the port authority. And my fellow speaker on the panel, Nubhan, will talk about the responsibilities of the port authority later in this session. Now, when it comes to rail, okay, rail is a bit far away, but let's talk about road, because road is one of those modes that connects air, connects sea, right? Because ships don't come to warehouses, nor do planes land at factories, right? You still need that main mode that's going to be doing the connecting to all these air and sea transportation. Now, when it comes to road transport, there are guidelines. There's this guideline known as the ADR. This is the UN regulations for road transport of dangerous goods. Now, in Malaysia, we have taken certain parts of this. For instance, we have got a road transport rules for packaged dangerous goods, where we have taken little bits of the ADR specifically with regards to the vehicle. Because as you can see in the ADR, it's broken to shipper's perspective. Now, shipper's perspective, it's already covered what I explained to you in the Purple Book and the GHS and whatnot. But now let's look at the carrier's perspective, because it's very important in the ADR, the responsibility in accepting dangerous goods begins when it comes to the service provider, begins with the trucker, the lorry driver, the guy that goes to the customer's place to pick the cargo. So the trucker now has to be trained, and this guy must know when he goes to pick up the goods that number one, it's packaged properly, it's marked and labeled properly. So there's a certain amount of training that is required. So in the ADR, we have the vehicle. And I know, I mean, before the pandemic, checking with JPJ. I understand JPJ is working on the AVR specs vehicles, but when it comes to the people portion of it, you know, the training of the people, because these rules are as good as they are, but if you don't understand how to read them, then it's pointless. So that's why all of these rules and regimes will ask you, train your people. And why are you training them? Generally, you're training them on how do they read these rules. So only if they understand how to read them, will they be able to apply them, right? So when it comes to this area, like for air and sea, it's clear. The Marine Department and CAAM dictate the training following the international requirements. But for road, there's still a little bit of a gap right there that needs to be corrected. That means there's a lot of room for us to fix this area being a main connector, yeah, a main mode connector. So shippers have to ensure. So the shipper, like, you know, the question is, and I've had this because I conduct a lot of training on DG, and I've had situations where the shippers would tell me, you know, we follow everything, you know. They like to call me madam. I don't like to feel I'm that old, but never mind. So, you know, madam, we follow everything. We classify, we use the UN approved packages and all that. And then there was this one instance when this actually happened and the container leaves the premise of the client heading towards the port. On the way to the port, the container catches fire and the client, the shipper is clueless because they're like, hey, I followed everything. How could it catch fire? So here is where the road transport comes in. And here is where for insurance, like the shipper, the manufacturer would have gone to claim. And the question will come up, the insurer will come up and say, are you trained to handle these goods? And of course, the shipper has to have it, has to ensure that they have staff that are trained and competent and they are compliant with the rules. Then the second question the insurer is going to ask them, are your logistics partners, that means your supply chain partners, are they trained and competent? So if that link is missing, it's going to be an issue for your insurance. So shippers have to make sure that their logistic partners are trained, you know, they're competent, they're trained, they know how to handle, because these goods are dangerous, right? We call them dangerous. And that these logistics services providers, not only do they have trained and competent people, but they're able to manage, they have a track record of being able to manage the transport of these goods and handling, and they follow the compliances and they're up to date. Very important that they are updated on it, yeah? So how then can shippers ensure, how do they know that, okay, are they trained or are they not trained? Are they competent? How do we bridge this gap? Because we can be fully compliant. And there are a lot of studies that I know of where a lot of shippers are complaining that their supply chain partners aren't compliant. So how do they do that then? So one of the things that we, now I come from the Chartered Institute of Logistics and Transport. And I told you in the earlier part of my presentation, I said, you know, 10 years ago, if somebody told me that I'll be connecting these dots, I'd laugh at them. Now, I have to owe this to CILT, honestly. I was conducting training, DG and all that. But I think when I joined the institute, you know, the professional body, and I got exposed to the international network, it's amazing. And one of the things that I learned was the global sustainability program is how we can actually connect these things together and actually use them. So I would say that we would recommend that shippers look at this as one of the requirements. That means the service providers, of course, the first thing is your service providers must be members of a reputable organization, like an association, like my fellow panel speaker, Mr. Alvin, Chua, who's the president of FMFF, should be a member of one of these organizations because they are always updated. They always inform their members and help out, assist. The second thing is ensure that the people that are working in that company that you have engaged as your 3PL, that they have professional qualifications, that, you know, they are CILT professionally qualified logisticians. Yeah, so this is one of the areas they can look at in bridging the gap. Now, what CILT has done, what the Chartered Institute has done, because we know that the ocean and the air is already sorted out, but we also know that in the road sector, there's a little bit of a gap. So we've come in to see how we can facilitate this gap. And we've created a program that is exactly as the ADR. So we've taken the ADR model And we have created a training program for drivers and vehicle crew, for transport personnel, because in the ADR, even packers have to go for training, the guys who are stuffing the containers, loaders, unloaders, customer service, and also DGSA. You see that dangerous goods safety advisor? So you saw that in Me Too, because we don't have that here in Malaysia. I had to do it in London in 2019. So we want to bring the DGSA here in Malaysia as well, which we have under the CILT network. And we work together with our global partners in this. We've learned, because in Ireland, it is CILT Ireland that is the examination body for the DGSA and the ADR training program. So we're trying to see how we can fit ourselves in here. So come back to this now, right? So I told you this whole thing, but kind of, I think I'm going way past time. So I'm going to quickly come down to how did I connect the dots? How does this, all these rules and regulations and provisions and guidelines, how do they connect to UN SDG goals? Now in UN SDG goals, you have to have your ESG framework, right? Your environmental, your social and governance. Let's look at environmental, all right? Now, if you don't follow the compliance, yeah, you are non-compliant. Obviously, there's volatile, highly reactive goods, because if you're not compliant, then you wouldn't have used the right packaging, which would have probably leaked during the journey, right? And which would have affected other cargoes, like what happened on Express Pearl, caused a massive devastation, not just to cargo and people's lives, but to the environment, which is livelihoods of people. So there you go, your E is there. Then we look at your S, which is your social. How does this help? How does this relate to your social goals? Now, when you follow these compliance rules and regulations, you're actually protecting people. You're protecting lives and you're protecting livelihoods. So of course, now when we come to governance, for corporate governance reasons, you're compliant, you can actually, you know, I'm not saying that there's corruption and all that, but when you fulfill your compliance requirements, you can actually do away with that and you actually address your risk management in your ESG framework. So cost of non-compliance will always outweigh the cost of compliance, right? So how does this relate to it? These rules and guidelines, these conventions, these provisions and guidelines, they actually help your companies to remain sustainable. So you can continue doing business with protecting people, protecting the planet, and generally ensuring that your company continues to excel. So I hope I was able to do that. Thank you very much. And I hope I didn't take too much of your time. Back to you, ma'am, doctor. Thank you very much.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much for a very interesting topics and very good presentation, Reshma. And you did highlighted about the dangerous good that need to be moved, even though you know it is very dangerous. And sometimes, and most of the case in a very large number quantity, we have seen. And they sometimes create disasters and impacted the environment in the soil planet, of course. So this is what we are worried of so much. And that's the reason why we should continue with our second speaker, our second panel. So I would like to introduce, Mr. Alvin Chua Sengwa. Yeah. Welcome, Mr. Alvin. And very short introduction. That Mr. Alvin is basically President of Federation of Nation Freight Forwarders, FMFF. He is also the Deputy President of Selangor Freight Forwarders and Logistics Association, SFFLA, and accredited members of FMFF. Mr. Alvin Chua became President of SFFLA in 2009 and has held the post of President until 2018. And in 2011, Mr. Alvin was elected as president of FMFF and his current term runs until 2021. At the regional level, Mr. Alvin Chua is the current vice chairman of AFFA, ASEAN Federation of Forwarders Association. He was vice chairman of AFPA from 2012-2014 and chairman from 2014 to 2016. And also a vice president in one in Malaysian National Shippers Council and has held the position since being elected in 2015. Lots of responsibility. Okay, he has been involved in the logistics industry for more than 40 years and has vast experience in shipping and freight forwarding industry. He runs his own company, Astrax Group of Companies, of which he holds the position of managing director. And also, Mr. Alvin actively participate in the academia with polytechnics, Utah, and Mr. Alvin also sits on the trade facilitation cluster working group in transport infrastructure and freight demand cluster working group under the National Logistics Task Force to implement the logistic and trade facilitation master plan. Very high-profile CV that we have here. And without further ado, I would like to pass the floor to you, Mr. Alvin. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Dr. Siti Zaharah, and a big welcome to all participants. Firstly, I would like to thank Dato Isham, Isha, our Secretary General, to be present today for his opening remark. And also, Dato Muhammad Muhiyuddin Haji Abdullah, our CLT Malaysia President, for giving me the opportunity, you know, to participate in this very important and webinar on this shipping of dangerous goods. Next. I'd like to introduce a little bit of our association, the Federation of Malaysian Freight Forwarders. Our association was registered in September 1987 as a national association representing the freight forwarders in the logistics industry. In the year 2000, the Ministry of Transport endorsed and recognized the Federation of Malaysian Freight Forwarders, or FMFF, as the national association to represent the logistics in the industry. Our federation actually comprises of Selangor Freight Forwarder Logistics Association, Penang Freight Forwarder Association, Johor Freight Forwarder Association, Labuan Freight Forwarder Association, Sarawak Forwarder Agency Association, Sabah Freight Forwarder Logistics Association, and also Malaysian Bumi Putra Logistics Association. And also the last one is the Sarawak and Sabah Shipping Owners Association. Okay. Altogether, currently we have 1,500 company members in our portfolio. FNFF is also affiliated to FIATA, or the International Federations of Freight Forwarder Association, the ASEAN Freight Forwarder Association, the Federation of Asia Pacific Air Cargo Association, and also lastly the Malaysian National Shipper Council. The Federations of Malaysian Freight Forwarder participate in many government forums, such as dialogues with the Ministry of Transport, which we sit as member in the National Logistics Task Force, the Ministry of International Trade and Industry, Ministry of Finance and Customs Liaison Meeting, and many other ministries. We also provide industry views and input for policy makers' consideration. And we also help all our members, you know, especially at the present pandemic, on all the SOPs and all the approvals of our mobility. We have regular dialogue even with the minister and also all the officers in MOT. Next. I wish to pick up where Reshma stopped just now, right? In international transport chain, the physical movement of goods begins after the buyers and seller have agreed on the terms of trade, or the Incoterm. The rules in the Incoterms will spell out to both parties on the cost and risk obligation in fulfilling choice of rule used in the sales contract. It is important, as an appointed agent, you must have proper training in Incoterm 2020 and advise your shipper properly and explain to them their risk obligation. Accredited forwarders and members of the Federation can use our standard trading condition to protect them against their liability and must explain and advise their customer on their obligation as an agent. Declaring and using the right approval and permit for their shipment, especially dangerous goods, is important to avoid any dispute and claim later. Next. When the goods move from the seller to buyers, the goods are passed over to 3PLs or forwarders who undertake the physical movement of the goods. Since the seller and buyer are not in control when the goods move, and since it is in the custody and care of the third party, they must purchase marine cargo insurance to cover their individual portions of risk in transit. When the Federation have, what our Federation have done for our member is we have arranged with logistic insurance service provider to draw a logistic liability insurance coverage covering our risk on transport document, cargo in transit, cargo liabilities, container liabilities, errors and omission, and many other type of specialty liabilities coverage needed as and when the shipments require. The Federation STC is used together with this liability insurance to protect our members against claims from shipper, and there's also clause in our trading condition that shipper must take up coverage for marine insurance for their goods. We also spell out the forwarder's responsibility while handling their goods, especially all the specialty good like dangerous good. Next. When it comes to dangerous good, the insurance cover will take into account the international and national provision and guidelines that facilitate the safe movements of these goods. It has been challenging for most businesses in the past 2 years due to this COVID-19 pandemic. In the logistic and trade facilitation sector, we have not been spared from this disruption caused by the pandemic. The COVID-19 spread to the world has led to lockdowns and border closure that restricted movement of goods. Social distancing at warehouses and place of work introduced by authorities to ensure the safety of workers also contributed to bottlenecks for freight and warehouses. A key lesson learned from this pandemic is that we need to be more agile and resilient than ever before. This should be our priority if we are to ensure that we survive and continue to sustain in this ever-changing world. Today, global value chains require greater resilience with its future uncharted. It is impossible to know in advance the challenges that may lurk in the future, even post-COVID-19. Next. Just now, Reshma have touched on this three provision. Each of these dangerous goods transport provision and guidelines have a chapter dedicated to competency training and certification for each individual mode specific guidelines. The aim is to ensure that individuals involved in the transport of dangerous goods are trained and competent in understanding and applying the provision and guidelines of this various code. Here you can see there is adequate training materials for all mode of transport, and each code and regulation must be understood by forwarders who are handling the domestic and international transportation of dangerous goods. For air, there are passengers on the deck while goods are in the belly of the aircraft. Please take note, 70% of air freight goods are shipped on passenger aircraft. So the air DGR training is a very important training program needed for all forwarders who handle dangerous goods or handling and packaging of dangerous goods. An example is the recent incident in Hong Kong, which a pallet of handphone with its lithium battery in it caught fire and destroyed all the goods. Luckily, this did not happen while the cargo was in flight. Many lives would have been lost if this happened. For sea transport, seaman life is also at risk if we don't follow the IMG code. That's why SOLAS were introduced for sea transport in Malaysia and also around the world. And for land, Malaysia have not adopted the area and multimodal regulation yet, as pointed out by this Reshma now. Most transporters, especially the oil and gas sector, self-regulate themselves. The government is now in the process of regulating the transport of dangerous goods under the ASEAN AFAJ. The protocol for moving of dangerous goods across border in ASEAN is a very important initiative, and the multi-modal law will soon be passed in Parliament in Malaysia for handling of dangerous goods across borders. Next. A freight forwarder or 3PL serves as a conduit for global trade between importer and exporter. The moment the freight forwarder sign or accept a contract, they are exposed to unique risks and liabilities. They may include, but not limited to, example, total loss of cargo may happen either due to physical cargo damage or theft while in the custody of the forwarder. Loss of money may happen if the customer does not pay them after the performance of part or all the activities. Damage of cargo may happen either due to incorrect or improper packaging of the cargo, incorrect or improper handling of the cargo while in the custody of the forwarder. Rerouting of cargo may happen when documentation submitted to the carrier by the forwarders was incorrect and cargo was routed elsewhere. Abandonment of cargo when cargo are abandoned by importer is another issue forwarders sometimes face. Non-collections of document by the customers, and the list goes on. But when the cargo is dangerous and hazardous, then it becomes the responsibility of the forwarders to ensure that the employees are trained and certified to be competent in complying with these rules and also the regulations. All this period can be covered when the forwarder had an adequate liability insurance coverage with them and also using the Federation standard trading conditions. Next. Allow me to share some cases that happened nationally and locally. I think so just now, Reshma have touched on this incident. Okay, carriage of dangerous goods requires special care. This was highlighted with devastating effect by the Beirut port explosion on August 2020. The tragedy at Beirut on August 4th highlights what happened when dangerous chemicals are not stopped with care. The explosion tore through the city, registering a force as strong as a 3.3 magnitude earthquake. Residents claimed that the scene looked like an apocalypse and that the port was totally destroyed. In this incident at Port of Beirut, the blast was likely caused by the detonation of more than 2,700 tons of ammonia nitrate, which has been stored at the dock since it was confiscated from the cargo ship. Ammonia nitrate is used both in agriculture fertilizer and in high-grade explosive. I think so, if you all can remember in 1980, this also happened in Port Klang South Port when the big explosion, you know, and fire, which really burned down the whole South Port, you know, and also killed quite a number of people in Port Klang. Things flew miles, you know, some of the steel. As of August 6th, the Beirut incident has left 135 dead, 1,000 injured, and 300,000 homeless. Specialists at the University of Sheffield in the UK estimate that the blast has about 1/10 of the explosive power of the atomic bomb dropped on the Japanese city of Hiroshima during World War II, and was unquestionably one of the biggest non-nuclear explosions in history. I also like to bring another case in Malaysia, right? In Malaysia, a vessel by the name of Ying Hua Fu, the forwarder declared the class and UN numbers of the dangerous chemical to be loaded in the port, to the load port authority without any appreciation of the significance. He did not have a copy of the IMDG code, and he simply forwarded the information given by the shipper. In the booking of the shipment with the shipping agent, the forwarder declared the cargo as innocuous agrochemical instead of their true nature. From the evidence of these various witnesses, it transpired, if there is not in dispute, that pursuant to the bills of lading, the shipper shipped the following cargo of agrochemical on board the vessel at Penang Port for delivery to their buyers in Miri, which actually contained dangerous chemical. This chemical produced products bear different characteristics identified by the UN and IMO class numbers. The BL described the cargo as 6 pallets said to contain agrochemical. The shipment was arranged by a forwarder or by a forwarding agent with a carrier in Penang. On 18 October 2008, an explosion took place on the Inghua Fu while cargo was being loaded on the vessel at wharf number 7, South Point in Port Klang. The explosion has been preceded by some spark, which become thick smoke within seconds, then fire, and subsequently an explosion within 5 to 7 minutes. The explosion which resulted was so great that the crew abandoned ship. Shortly after the explosion, the bow of the ship started to sink. Within a time period of 10 minutes, the entire vessel sank in Port Klang. No life was lost, luckily, nor injury sustained, but widespread damage was caused to the vessel and the cargo. The carrier claimed against both the shipper and the freight forwarders for all loss suffered as a result of this explosion and also the sinking of their vessel. The chemical which was stored on deck caught fire and exploded when the vessel arrived at the subsequent port, sinking the vessel within 20 minutes. Right, so the court, they went to court and the court found that the forwarder and the shipper have failed to declare and was negligent, which caused the damage of the sinking of this vessel. All right, the detail and the provision of the IMDG code and material safety data sheet pertaining to this cargo carried, which was submitted by both the forwarder and the shipper, was irrelevant because they say that this is not a really dangerous good, right? In the end, who will pay for all this one? Actually, it's the shipper, and also the forwarder was found guilty and they were taken to court and they have to pay the losses, right? So it is important that any forwarder who want to handle dangerous good must ensure that their staff are adequately trained and certified as per what Reshma said just now, right? And shipper must always ask their appointed forwarder for evidence of trainings and certification of the staff who are qualified to handle dangerous goods before handling over their dangerous goods shipment to them. Next. In conclusion, all logistics service provider must ensure their staff must be properly trained with certification from the various accredited government agency or organization with approved institution doing their training, be it sea, land, or air transportation, including warehousing for dangerous goods. In Port Klang or in Malaysia, we have CLLB, the Federation of Malaysian Freight Forwarder, IATA, and a few other institutions providing this specialized awareness or certified DG training. For logistic companies, they should join an accredited association like us, the Federation, which have training or risk management via our standard trading condition and insure their company with tailored logistic liability insurance to cover against claims or losses while handling any type of goods for their customer. Please take note, only members of the Federation via the state association can use our Federation STC. On this note, I would like to present today, we'll have a better understanding of the importance in training and certification to be a professional logistician in handling of all goods for the customer, especially dangerous goods. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Alvin. Not so much here for me to recap because we have a very clear explanation from Mr. Alvin just now on shipping dangerous goods by sea, talking from the freight forwarders and 3PL, third party logistics service provider perspective. Thank you very much, Mr. Alvin, once again. Okay, let's go next and listen from the other perspective, okay? And this time we go to M. Wilson from the perspective of Port Authority. So I would like to welcome on the screen Encik Nubhan bin Basarudin. Okay. All right. So let me introduce our speaker. Next speaker, Mr. Nubhan bin Basarudin, started working at the Port Klang Authority in 1997 at the Vessel Traffic Management System, VTMS unit. And in 2016, he was transferred to the Dangerous Goods Department and promoted to manager in 2014. And he is responsible for enforcing the Port Klang Authority by Law Amendment 1989, as well as in the regulation in handling, transporting and storing dangerous cargoes at the port. He graduated from UITM in Business Administration. And in addition, he also holds the NEBOSH, NEBOSH, International General Certificate in Employment, Health and Safety. He represents PKA in various security committees set up by the government agency. He is a member of National Standards Committee, the Packaging and Logistic Industry Standard Committee, and also Technical Committee for the Transportations of Dangerous Goods. Okay, without further ado, I would like to welcome Encik Nubhan. Kita silakan. Maybe Encik Nubhan still mute ke?
Okay, assalamualaikum and a very good afternoon to Yang Berbahagia Dato' Isham Ishak, Secretary General of Ministry of Transport, Yang Berusaha Dato' Muhammad Muhiyuddin, Haji Abdullah, President of CILTM, speakers and to all participants, thank you Dr. Siti Zaharah and the organizer for giving Port Klang Authority the opportunity to share how we handle dangerous goods in the port. Okay. Today, my presentation will comprise as follows. First, I will explain the definition of the dangerous goods. Then I will share the statistics on the handling of dangerous goods, the acts and guidelines enforced, regulation and facilities available in the port, enforcement and training, and also some accidents that occur in the port. So when we talk about dangerous goods, we start with a question. What are dangerous goods or DG? And the answer same as what Reshma explained just now. Generally, dangerous goods are substances and articles when transported by air, sea, road and rails that are potentially dangerous and capable of posing significant risk to health, safety, property, environment and security. So identifying dangerous goods is the first step to reduce risk posed by the product with proper packaging, communication, handling, and also storage. A good starting point for determining if your products might be dangerous is by obtaining a safety data sheet from the manufacturer and checking the transport information in the section 14. This can provide valuable information on the transport risk related to the materials. And recommendation on the safe transports of dangerous cargoes and related activities in the port areas, 2000 edition states, dangerous cargoes means any of the following cargoes, whether packaged, carried in bulk packaging, or in bulk within the scope of the following instrument. Number one, oil covered by Annex 1 of MIPOL 7378. Number two, gases covered by the codes for the construction and equipment of ships carrying liquefied gases in bulk, or we call it IGC code. Number three, noxious liquid substances or chemicals, including waste, covered by the codes for the construction and equipment of ships carrying dangerous chemical in bulk, or IBC code, and Annex 2 of MARPOL 7378. Number four, solid bulk materials possessing chemical hazards and solid bulk materials hazardous only in bulk or MHB including waste covered by Group B schedules in the Code of Safe Practice for Solid Bulk Cargo, or we call it International Maritime Solid Bulk Cargo Code. Number five, harmful substances in package form covered by Annex 3, MARPOL 7378, and dangerous goods, whether substances, materials, or articles covered by the IMDG code. The terms dangerous cargoes include any empty, unclean packaging, such as tank containers, receptacles, IBC or intermediate bulk containers, bulk packaging, portable tanks or tanks vehicles, which previously contained dangerous cargoes, unless the packagings have been sufficiently clean of residue. So if you talk about dangerous cargoes, this is the items, okay? And dangerous goods are categorized into 9 hazard classes. Class 1, explosive, for example, bomb, ammunition, fireworks. Class 2, gases, for example, LPG, refrigerant gas or ammonia gas. Class 3, flammable liquid, for example, paints or toluene, xylene. Class 4, flammable solid, substances liable to spontaneous combustion. Substances which in contact with water emit flammable gases, for example, aluminium powder, activated carbon or calcium carbide. Class 5, ammonium nitrate, oxidizing substances, for example, ammonium nitrate and organic peroxide. Example, organic peroxide type B, C, D, E, or F. Class 6, toxic and infectious substance, for example, organophosphorus pesticide or biological substances. Class 7 falls under radioactive material, for example, cobalt 60, yellow cake. Class 8, corrosive, acid, alkali. Class 9, miscellaneous dangerous substances, for example, safety devices, or lithium batteries, VRLA batteries, and etc. And based on the statistics on handling of dangerous cargoes last year, Port Klang handled almost 200,000 TEUs, where 45% were transshipment, 36% were import, and 19% were export cargoes. And based on this declaration that we processed last year, 33% were IMO class 3, flammable liquid, 21% IMO class 9, miscellaneous dangerous goods substances, 18% IMO class 8, corrosive substances, 17% IMO class 2, gases, 6% IMO class 6, toxic, 3% IMO class 5, oxidizing agent, 2% IMO class 4, flammable solid, 0.15% IMO class 1, explosive, fireworks, and 0.01% IMO class 7, radioactive. Last year, we only handled 22 TEUs radioactive in the port. So to ensure smooth operations with a large number of declarations every day, there should be X bylaws, SOPs, and guidelines in place. In Port Klang, among the acts that we use are the Port Authorities Act 1963 as the main act, and also the Port Privatization Act 1990. We also enforce Klang Port Authority Bylaws Amendment 1989, or we call it DP Bylaws, which clearly explain the requirement for every dangerous goods to be declared to the Port Authority. And in addition, the handling of dangerous goods must comply with the requirement in the IMDG code in terms of placards, labels, and storage in the port. And we also provide guidelines for the reference of port users, such as guidelines for delivery of import and export dangerous goods, PKA Group 2, guidelines for transshipment of dangerous goods via Port Klang, and also notices from time to time. These guidelines can be obtained in our website. Yeah. And apart from that, there are acts from other government agencies that support the enforcement of dangerous goods in port, such as the Merchant Shipping Ordinance 1952, especially Part 5, Safety, Carriage of Dangerous Goods. Environmental Quality Act 1974 for shipment of scheduled waste. Petroleum Safety Measures Act 1984 to handle petroleum product. Atomic Energy Licensing Act 1984, especially for handling of radioactive and nuclear material. And also the Strategic Trade Act, SCA 2010 for dual-use cargoes. And the handling of dangerous goods involves parties at the port of loading and also port of discharge. As such, we also comply with the relevant international instruments and guidelines, such as International Maritime Dangerous Goods or IMDG Code. And currently, we comply to the Amendment 3918. And the next year, we will start using Amendment 4020. So there are four new UN numbers listed in the new amendment. There are three under IMO Class 1 explosive, and one under IMO Class 6.2, infectious substances. And we also comply to the International Maritime Solid Bulk Cargoes Code for handling of solid bulk cargoes. Currently, we comply to Amendment 0519, and also we refer to recommendation on the safe transport of dangerous cargoes and related activities in the port area, International Convention for the Safety of Life at Sea, SOLAS, International Convention for the Prevention of Pollution from Ships, MARPOL, IMO, ILO, UNECE, Code of Practice for Packing of of Cargo Transport Unit or CTU Code. And we'll also comply to the Basel Convention on the Control of Transboundary Movement of Hazardous Waste and Their Disposal, and also International Convention for Safe Containers, 1972, CSC. And PKA regulations, any dangerous goods brought into the port must be declared to the port authority at least 48 hours prior to the vessel arrival by master, owner or agent, or shipper or his agent. Container packing certificate is required for export dangerous goods container, and permit from Atomic Energy Licensing Board for IMO Class 7, PDRM for Class 1, Ministry of Health for Class 6.2, and also waste from DOE. Also required to be attached in the declaration. And any package containing dangerous goods brought into the port shall be clearly marked and labeled in accordance with the requirement of the IMDG code. And also any freight container, portable tank or other transport unit containing dangerous goods brought into the port shall be clearly marked and placarded in accordance with the requirement of the IMDG code. And for dangerous goods that is allowed to be stored in the port, it will be stored at the designated storage facilities. To facilitate the operations of dangerous goods in port, both terminal operators, North Port and West Port, provide the handling and storage facilities, such as dangerous goods yard, dangerous goods shed, recovery area and bathtub trailer for leakage or spillage dangerous goods, and also registered dangerous goods contractor to do the reworking of the spillage or leakage dangerous goods. And currently, we have four companies registered to do the reworking of dangerous goods in the port. And for the declaration of dangerous goods, all processes are done online. Okay, the declarant must complete the information such as dangerous good details, the UN number, the IMO class, sub-hazard if applicable, the proper shipping name, the fresh point if applicable, and also the packing group. And cargo details such as cargo type, quantity and weight, the PKA group, port of loading, and also port of discharge. And the PKA group can be obtained in our website as well. Yeah? And vessel information such as vessel name, vessel ID, voyage number, ETA, ETD, and also the declarant information, such as declarant details and also shipping and forwarding agent details. And to ensure that dangerous goods handled in the port comply with the requirement of the DG bylaws and the IMDG code, enforcement is always in place. Regular inspections are carried out at wharf, container yards, and also warehouses. Port safety audit are also conducted on terminal operators to review their procedures annually. Awareness programs such as dialogues, meetings, and training were also implemented to port users to resolve all issues related to the handling of dangerous goods. In the event of non-compliance with the DG bylaw, legal action will be taken, and if found guilty, according to Section 29, Subsection 3A, Port Authorities Act 1963, fine not exceeding 1,000 ringgit per offence. and enforcement for IMO Class 7 radioactive material under the Customs Megaport Initiative, coordination with the Royal Malaysian Customs Department and also the Atomic Energy Licensing Board to detect, prevent and interdict trafficking in nuclear and other radioactive materials. Radiation portal monitor installed at the wharfs to scan container traffic with key radiation detection equipment. And in terms of training, it is mandatory for shore-based personnel since 1 January 2010. IMDG code requires all those involved in dangerous goods transport by sea to be trained in general awareness, function-specific, and also security training. If you or your staff in the company handle these functions, persons involved must receive the required training. And currently, there are two institutions approved by the Malaysian Marine Department to give the training, CLLB and also the PLOMO group. Okay. And regular inspection of export containers, leaking containers, and reports from terminal operators indicate some non-compliance with the IMDG code. Some dangerous goods are badly packed, no damage, poor damage, drum in upside down position, heavier goods on top of lighter goods, non-compliance with the regulations in terms of labeling, placarding, documentation, packages, UN approval mark, segregation, and also no declaration of misdeclaration. For example, only one dangerous goods is declared instead of five in the containers. So you know how dangerous is it, yeah? And history has shown that most accidents occur due to negligence, taking shortcuts or otherwise non-compliant with rules and procedure, resulting in leakage, fire and explosion, and also death. And for example, fire is due to undeclared dangerous goods will jeopardize port operations and the safety of the vessel as well. And leakage is due to not comply with the packaging requirement. Okay. These are the example of the consequences for the non-compliance of the regulation. Yeah. Fatality, explosion and fire, leakage. And I will share some sad episodes that happened in Port Klang. The first incident occurred on 20th June 1992 involving motor tanker Chun Hong 3 at the Shell Petrochemical Depot, Port Klang. This tanker carries two types of dangerous goods, toluene and xylene. And the cause of accident was due to human negligence while using the portable pump and hose, which resulted in 13 workers and crew being killed. After this incident, some suggestions were made. First, to follow the approved guideline and SOPs to increase the enforcement and also routine inspection to all the equipments involved. And the second accident occurred on 18th July 2001. Okay. Ships from Kaohsiung carry transit dangerous goods, polymeric bead expandable, evolving flammable vapor, UN2211, IMO class 9. These dangerous goods are a molding material in bead or granular consisting predominantly of polystyrene, polymethyl methacrylate, or other polymeric materials containing 5 to 8% of a volatile hydrocarbon, which is predominantly pentane. Pentane, yeah. During storage, a small proportion of this pentane is released into the atmosphere. This proportion increases at elevated temperatures. This DD exploded inside hatch number 2, which resulted in the hatch cover blowing off the vessel. Lucky there was no fatality. IMDG code requires this DD to be stored on deck or if under the deck, in a hole that is mechanically ventilated. As the container staff with IMO class 9, UN2211, were not declared, yeah, this cargo were not declared, the containers were stored in an unventilated hole. As a result, the flammable gases evolving from the container accumulated in the space and eventually an explosion atmosphere formed, and it was this that was subsequently ignited. So result of the explosion, one lashing gang member while unlashing container in the adjacent cargo hold was burned, critical but survived. Five containers on deck were blown into the sea. One container was blown onto the wharf. Three containers were dislodged between the vessel and the key crane on shore. 10 containers lie damaged on deck. The hatch cover where the explosion took place buckled. And the compound issue was only 12,000 ringgit at that time. Okay. And the third accident happened October 2008, as what Mr. Alvin explained just now. Vessel Ing Huafu, number 9, carried the transit cargo at Port Klang from Penang to Bintulu. A cargo ship loaded with chemicals and steel products exploded in the huge fireball and sank at South Point, Port Klang. No casualties, but the sheer force of the blast, shattered windows and shock wave were felt up to 3 kilometers away. There were 4 undeclared dangerous goods on board. UN number 1495, oxidizing agent. UN number 3018, toxic substances. UN number 3345, toxic substances. And also the environmental hazardous substance, yeah. 3082 IMO class 9. And the penalty was issued only 2,000 ringgit at that time. Yes, very small. So that is all my presentation today. And thank you for your kind attention. And if you have any inquiries, please do not hesitate to contact me or my department or send an email to this address. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Okay, Nubhan, it's very interesting as well that now we know what is actually all the process, SOP procedures in Port Klang. And I believe that there is a very strict regulation imposed by PKA in order to deal with DCG, either for storage and also shipment by sea. And but still, yeah, the incident accidents consequence of this non-compliance to DG SOP regulation had happened. So okay, so we are waiting for questions from the audience. Yeah, please drop some questions in the chat panel and also the Q&A panel, so that at the end of this session we will read through your questions and pose to the presenter. And without further ado, let we go straight to the fourth panel today, that will talk about the carrier and ship perspective. And I would like to welcome Yang Bursa Captain Cadet Koo to be on screen. Okay. All right. I would like to introduce Captain Cadet Koo. He's a Malaysian Master Mariner who is presenting the GM for CLS Shell Marine Group of Companies, which operates in East Malaysia. He is also the head of Sea Master Simulator Center, located in Mirian KK, which is equipped with state and the art bridge and engine room simulator, SECDIS or GMDSS lab for the conduct of various STCW Certificate of Proficiency COP courses, as well as offshore vessel bridge console simulator. His main responsibility with CILTM Marine is to oversee the activities and operations of the company, which involve maritime training and marine consultancy services for the related marine, offshore and port industry within the region. His CV is very vast, with a lot of experience, and with this CILTM Marine, which was the winner of the Outstanding Performance Award for Maritime Institute during the Malaysia World Maritime Week 2018. He actively involved himself in initiatives to develop the capacity building and human resources aspect of the maritime industry, particularly in East Malaysia. Without further ado, I would like to welcome Captain Kenneth Koo.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Moderator. I normally do this. It's just a habit of mine. Every time when I come online, ever since we started doing all this thing online, I normally just check with everyone. Is the audio okay? Can everybody see me clearly? It's just occupational hazard. So thank you very much for the extensive introduction. I got to remind myself to kind of shorten that CV and biodata for further webinars. Datuk-datuk, datin-datins, professors, associate professors, distinguished guests from abroad as well as from local, those from Malaysia. A very good evening. I'm Kenneth Koo, and I'll be talking about carrier's perspective in shipping packaged dangerous goods by sea. When we talk about carrier's perspective here, I'm going to be touching on the shipping company, the master, as well as the crew members on board. Now, they are the hidden component of this supply chain of dangerous goods. They're seldom seen, but they play a key role in transporting dangerous goods across the oceans and towards the various destinations in the world. Normally, when I start my training, I like to do something to get the attention of the audience. So here's a very brief story about flight, value jet flight 952, which in 1996, it was a McDonnell Douglas aircraft, which in 1996 took off from Miami Airport and was heading towards Atlanta. There was a last minute loading of some boxes of oxygen, used oxygen generators into the cargo hold before she took off. The cargo was not declared. It was poorly packed and it was just simply chucked into a cargo compartment in a plane close to a few tires that was also part of the cargo in the plane. The plane took off. Due to vibration and movement of the aircraft, that poorly packed oxygen generator started to heat up. And to cut a long story short, it started a fire. Now, if you are familiar with the fire triangle, you probably know that you need heat, fuel, and oxygen for the fire to continue and expand. In a cargo compartment, everybody assumes that, well, if a fire starts, okay, sooner or later, the oxygen is going to run out. The fire is going to die down. When you have an oxygen generator in the cargo hold, what happens is that those equipment keeps on generating oxygen. And when the fire started, instead of dying out because of lack of oxygen, it just expanded. It just started to get bigger and bigger and bigger until the fire caught hold of the electronic wiring of the plane. Ultimately, with the burning of the tires and all that, the pilot not only lost control of the plane, but they also ended up being unconscious. The plane crashed into the Everglades and killing 110 passengers and crew at the same time. So I thought I'd go on the aviation side because the other panelists were talking about incidents and accidents which were occurring on board ship. Right, so that's the story. So I hope I've gotten your attention with regards to this. I'd like to start off with a little bit of introduction about the Malaysian Maritime Education and Training Association. If you have not heard of us, okay, I'm not surprised because we are quite new. We were formed in 2014, okay? And we started off with, I think, around 7 or 8 members only. And then ultimately, we have expanded to 25 current members, all of whom are approved maritime training institutes or approved maritime training service providers, okay? The main mission and vision for MIMET is to be the premier non-profit organization to facilitate development and standardization of maritime education and training in Malaysia, not only to fulfill our own national requirement, but also to fulfill the global requirement as set by the International Maritime Organization. Okay, when the idea of MIMAT was initiated, the intention was to come up with an association to complement the maritime related agencies in terms of seafarers training, certification and development. And so far, touch wood, 7 years have passed. We have quietly gone about our work. There's a lot of work that has been done behind the scenes, and we thank the Marine Department of Malaysia for assisting and facilitating the work that we currently are doing. And when it comes to dangerous goods, a few years ago, we had a workshop in MITRANS in Port Klang, whereby we came up with a standardized or generic syllabus with regards to IMDT training, not only the general awareness, but the FS training as well, the function specific training as well. And during that workshop, the Marine Department appointed MIMAT as the examination committee in terms of monitoring and undertaking examinations related to dangerous goods, which is conducted by members of MIMAT. So that's a little bit of background with regards to the association. Okay. Now, when we look at dangerous goods, it goes way, way back. When we're talking about dangerous goods by sea, it all started after SOLAS. We all know about Titanic. We all know about how SOLAS came about. But when we talk about dangerous goods, it came slightly a little bit after that. Even before SOLAS, the industry, okay, the sea industry, the shipping industry was worried about the amount of chemicals that we were transporting all around the world without any form of regulations whatsoever. So in 1929, SOLAS itself officially recognized the need for international regulations with regards to transportation and carriage of dangerous goods by sea. Okay, but the problem is when you have an international association or international organization like IMO saying something and coming up with something sometimes takes a very long time. And what happens was that it was not until 1948 that SOLAS adopted the classification of dangerous goods. So see how long it took from the time that they made the statement until the time that they came up with something. And ultimately, in 1965, the IMDG code was launched. Now, the problem with having a code and not having something that's mandatory is that when something is voluntary, sometimes it's very difficult for parties or for those who are within the stakeholders to comply with. So it was there, okay, but we didn't see too many shipping companies, too many stakeholders using it. Right. I remember during my sailing days, okay, quite some way, I think probably about 30 years ago, we used to transport dangerous goods. And what we did was, whatever was being loaded, we just asked them for the documentation and that's it. We never went into the IMDG code. And I'll tell you why. The old IMDG code was 4 volumes of this thick blue book, which was, I don't know how they basically arranged it, but I think there were about 10,000 pages in them. So nobody wanted to take the effort of going in to find the information about the cargo that we are transporting in 10,000 pages of unsystematically arranged IMDG. Thankfully, in the year 2000, things were slightly improved. We sort of like came up with a more user-friendly IMDG code, and that's what we have currently. 2 volumes, 1 supplement, amended every 2 years, because supplements sometimes extend beyond the 2 years, and it's a bit more easier for companies or for the stakeholders to be utilizing it. And not to mention the fact that this also helps. In 2004, we made it mandatory that you have to comply with the requirements of the IMDG code in order for you to be allowed to transport dangerous goods. Now, once it becomes mandatory, everybody starts scrambling. Okay, where's the code? Where's the code? Let's look at what basically we need to comply with in order to be allowed to transport those dangerous goods. So thankfully, with the code being mandatory, with the fact that the IMDG code was a bit more user-friendly, you find more extensively, you find that the document is more extensively used nowadays. Okay, now the definition has been done by my two fellow panelists earlier. But here's another thing that probably is information for especially students. In Malaysia and in most countries or member states around the world, we call it dangerous goods. In certain countries, such as the US, in Canada and all that, they don't call it dangerous goods. They call it hazmat or hazardous materials, which is kind of weird because why they call it hazmat there. Over here, we call it dangerous goods. Our fire brigade don't have dangerous goods team, but they have hazmat teams. So go figure out how that came about. So that's the definition of dangerous goods. Now, when we talk about environment, see, I split the living organisms effect there with the environment, because when we talk about environment, it's not only things that are going into the sea, into the water, and them and sort of like affecting our living organisms. It is also things that are being released out into the atmosphere. That is also pollution. That is also impacting on environment. So there's two impacts there with regards to the impact of dangerous goods to the environment. Okay, when we look at the international legal framework of IMDG, we have to look at two conventions. One is SOLAS, okay, and another one is MARPOL. If you go into SOLAS, you open up chapter 7, there is a provision with relation to carriage of dangerous goods. You go into MARPOL, you open up annex number 3, okay, carriage of harmful substances in package form, i.e. prevention of pollution from harmful substances in package form. That is the convention that is related. That is the annex that is related. Those two are the parent conventions. And then after that, you've got the IMDG code in terms of the implementation part. But the parent conventions are from those two conventions. So what you have now is the code, which contains the detailed technical specifications to allow for dangerous goods to be safely transported by sea. When I talk about safely now we've got to worry about another aspect of transporting dangerous goods. And that is described in, I think, part 1.4 in volume 1 of the code. When we talk about safety, now we also have to worry about security. Okay. Although I know this is going a little bit more into the training. Just when we were dealing with security, we've got to worry about another thing. Because some of the documentations are being handled not only in hard copy, we are going into digitization and all that. We now have to worry about cyber security in terms of dangerous goods. So we're trying to catch up here. We're trying to play catch up here. So we've got to keep going to catch up with the situation that's going out there, what the conditions are in relation to dealing with dangerous goods. And sometimes it's not easy. Okay? Sometimes it's not easy, especially with regards to trying to cascade this information to those who are working on board ship and also to the shipping companies itself. So the objectives of the code itself is to enhance the safe transport of dangerous goods, okay, to protect the marine environment, both okay, marine and also the atmosphere, and to facilitate the free and restricted movement of dangerous goods, not only across countries, but across the supply chain. Because from the manufacturer to the end user, you could be passing by two or three types of mode of transport. So the code itself will allow for this to happen. That means certain information are standard across the whole chain, supply chain of transport. So as I mentioned just now, 1st January 2004, it became mandatory. And in terms of the principles, and when I'm doing the principles now, I'm just going to tell you how it impacts on the carrier. Carrier meaning the company, the master, the shipping company, the master and the crew. So The code was based on an internationally agreed system, which number one, groups the dangerous goods together based on the hazards they present in transport, i.e. classification. We all know that classification is being done by the United Nations Committee of Experts. Secondly, contains the dangerous goods in packages and tanks which are appropriate strength, which will prevent the goods escaping. That means containers, crates, okay, ISO tanks, those kind of packaging. Uses hazards, warning labels, and other identifying marks to identify dangerous goods in transport. Labels, placards for containers, CTUs. So those are the what do you call it? The identification part. Now, here is the part where now we come in. Okay. The principles so lays down principles for ensuring that dangerous goods which will react dangerously together are kept apart. Together with the next one, it lays down principles for where to place dangerous goods on board ship to ensure safe transport. And this is where that stowage and segregation part comes in. And this is where our role is to make sure that yes, somebody else decides where it's to be loaded, but it is for us to make sure that it's being stored at the right place with the right segregation based on the class of dangerous goods that's being put on board the ship. Okay. And next, it also provides emergency response advice for dangerous goods involved in a fire or spillage on board ship. Now, this is described in the supplement of the IMDG code. Okay. So if you look at the process, classification is done by external party, packaging, marking, identification, labeling and all that is done by the shipper. Even though to a certain extent, the carrier has the responsibility of understanding what is the correct type of packaging, what is the correct type of marking, is it easy to identify according to what the IMDG recommends, are the labels correct, is it utilizing the correct kind of labeling, are the location of the labelings correct. So these are the things that we are not directly responsible, but indirectly, they need to know about these things. In terms of a direct responsibility, okay, the documentation, which I'll explain a bit later, the stowage and segregation, and of course the emergency procedures. Okay, if we look at volume, the IMDG code, you've got two volumes and one supplement. Part one, of course, contains volume one contains part 1-7, with the exception of part 3, which is contained in volume 2. And this is where the crux, the main information that we need in terms of dangerous goods is in the DGL. Okay. The supplement contains emergency response procedures for ships. Just now, as I mentioned, spillages, fires. It also contains guidance on medical first aid, what to do in terms of in case somebody gets injured when handling dangerous goods. And of course, there are also information relating to the reporting procedures. Who do they report to? They report to the coastal state's competent authority. Of course, in the case of Malaysia, it is the Marine Department of Malaysia. 9 classes. Even though you've got 9 classes, if you look further into the code, there are some subdivisions and some additional classes attached to each of a few of those classes. Okay, in terms of documentation, the documentation has got to contain information such as the UN number, the 4-digit UN number, and also the proper shipping name for the PM. Okay, trade names alone shall not be used. Okay, when you're describing the goods, it should use the correct description as required by the various documentation used in transportation of dangerous goods. And the shipper shall ensure that whatever declaration that you are making in relation to the dangerous goods, it has to be consistent with the dangerous goods itself. Just now we were listening about undeclared, misdeclared, as well as poorly packed dangerous goods. So that is the responsibility of the shipper. And as you probably know, that is very important for us on board the ship. That is very important for the carrier, because whatever you hand over to us, after that, we will have to deal with it in case something goes wrong during the voyage. And you know, as you probably know, during sea voyage, we can experience things such as typhoons, storms, heavy weather, rough seas and all that. So we wouldn't want to have to deal with spillage and ultimately fire of dangerous goods because they were not properly packed. Okay, so this is the first document which I'd like to raise with regards to this, with regards to dangerous goods. This is the dangerous goods declaration form. Okay. Yes.
Perhaps you have left about two minutes to wrap up.
Okay, all right. This is the dangerous goods declaration form. Okay. And of course, you also have the manifest, which can be replaced by the cargo plan as well. And this is important. This is normally done by the carrier, whether in the company or on board the ship, to indicate what are the dangerous goods being, all the dangerous goods being carried on board the ship, where they are located, what's the quantity, where is the discharge port, and all the other information. This is to assist the people on board in the unlikely case that something goes wrong during the voyage. Okay, so the ship's crew should be able to identify the danger goods via the 4-digit UN number and the correspondence proper shipping name. Why is that important? Why? Because they should be able to sort of like immediately ensure rapid and precise identification of those goods during transport, if and when needed, including during emergency. Okay, so these are some of the marking, labeling, and placarding on the goods. You've got some information relating to packing group 1, 2, and 3, indicating high, medium, and low danger. Okay, and of course, packing specifications as well. Okay, all right. So just a final part here. These are the category of segregation that you can find under Table 7.4 in Volume 1 of the IMDG code. Now, I conduct a lot of training in relation to dangerous goods in Brunei. A lot of them ask me, we look at the segregation table, but we find that on board offshore support vessels, it is almost impossible to attain that kind of segregation that is given in the IMDG code. Okay? Because it's only a single deck and you don't have much space. So what we tell them is you can refer to certain guidance issued by other member states, which is specifically for offshore support vessels. For example, the UK MCA has got MGN 282, which is specifically giving you guidance on how to segregate, how to sort of like have that kind of segregation on supply vessels. So it's a little bit more flexible, but it can be used if and when needed, provided the competent authority approves it. And of course, in the emergency response procedures, they are trained to refer to the supplement in relation to any emergencies. Okay. Final one, the training and competency of the crew members on board are given in STCW table A2/2-2 and also STCW B-5. Okay, those are for the officers, masters, and also for all the crew members. Okay. All right. On a final note, I know this is slightly a bit off topic. If you can give me just 2 minutes, Madam Moderator. Okay. It's slightly off topic, but I wish to speak on behalf of a key component of the dangerous goods supply chain, which is the seafarers who are on board transporting all these dangerous goods. Okay. Now, if we accept that these seafarers are key component of the dangerous goods supply chain, if we accept that they are key workers, which has already been agreed by in the IMO, if we agree that they are part of the frontliners and serving the essential services, and if they have been fully vaccinated, then the guidance on the signing on and signing off by the coordinating agency, which is the Marine Department, the Malaysian Marine Department, should be taken into account. So in that case, we wish to request that the various agencies take into consideration a little bit of flexibility in the regulations regarding the signing on and signing off, as well as the quarantine of those seafarers who are serving our industry, including the transportation of dangerous goods. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay, thank you very much, Cap. It's very informative information and also quite intensive discussion, yeah, in terms of the request as well. So I believe there are quite a number of agencies as well here attending our webinar. And due to the time constraint, I'll go straight away to the Q&A, and I am very glad that some of the questions is already answered at the Q&A Q&A panel. So some of the questions being answered, and some of the questions still require very short answer from the panel. So I go straight to this very quick one. Perhaps this question to Reshma. In Asia, there is a glaring gap of the transportation of DG by road. What are the strategies being drafted by CLT or perhaps MOT to address this gap from budget safety?
Yeah, well, I would say that on MOT side itself, MOT land and logistics, if KSU is still on, he can talk about it, but MOT is already working with regards to the rules and guidelines related to road transport of DG. And when it comes to CILT, because it's a lot to adopt the ADR in Malaysia, we may not be able to adopt 100%, but the ADR also requires training as well, as you have seen from most of our panel speakers have mentioned that, right? So the training portion of it is being conducted by CILT. So CILT Malaysia comes in for the human resource competencies and certification.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. And next question, perhaps to Mr. Alvin, very quick one, Mr. Alvin. The scenario explosions of Port of Beirut in 2020 has devastated areas surrounding the port. Eh? To avoid such scenario happening in Malaysia, there should be demand or enforced legal requirement in managing DG cargoes. Questions, how does MOT should participate in this matter, especially related to the regulation in managing DG goods? Perhaps can wrap MOT to answer this question, Mr. Alvin.
Actually, as you are aware, all of us here are aware of dangerous goods. The warehousing part, there is no regulation at the moment for anybody or anyone who wants to sell a warehouse to store dangerous goods. This is, again, all self-regulating, you know, and the only requirement to set up a warehouse to store any goods is actually the local council and also Womba. That's all it. Right. So actually, the government should seriously look at this, you know, it's been happening just last week. You saw one plastic recycle factory just burn off, right? The whole thing, you know, because there's no safety and there's no requirement from the regulatory body for this type of setup, you know. Not just, you should look at Singapore as an example, you know, they have put this this initiative and government this approval to set up dangerous goods warehousing. And as and for transport, like what Reshma has said, the ADR must be adopted now with training for drivers, for warehouse operators, for owners, you know, of goods, you know, how to handle dangerous goods at road. You know, this also we have seen also many times that tankers blown up, you know, on highways. You know, how are we going to curb this now if our drivers are not trained? Okay, that's my comment.
Thank you, Mr. Alvin. And I believe we received quite a lot of questions there. Some of it is actually can be answered at the answered panel. But perhaps these last questions that I would like to read here, and the rest, I hope that all the panels can read through the questions and can give some answer in the Q&A chat box, yeah? And the Q&A panel, right? So perhaps this is a quick question. Shipping DG goods has always been a challenge, mainly because it's very common for liners to reject such cargo. Please comment. So I would like to open this to any one of the panel so that we can have a very quick answer on this. Anyone from perhaps Cap?
All right. We have been hearing stories nowadays with regards to either misdeclared or underdeclared, as well as of dangerous goods by the shippers towards the carriers. It's been going on for quite some time now. I can see that now what's happening is that the carriers are starting to get a little bit tough with regards to this. For example, certain shipping lines are coming up with fines to the amount of like sometimes 35,000, 15,000, all that. So hopefully, with this kind of action being taken by the carrier, we can see a little more improvement from the shippers in taking their responsibility with regards to transporting of dangerous goods a little bit more seriously. And once everybody does their responsibility according to the requirement of the various regulations, then it will be much more easier in transporting dangerous goods. Thank you.
All right. We have a lot here that require maybe last lucky one. Non-compliant, if caused by ignorance, we can provide awareness and training. But if it is due to a great exploitative and heartlessness, so how? So perhaps this is a very sophisticated question. So perhaps anyone that would like to have this.
Can I ask Encik Nubhan to answer that? Because the authority is pretty strong on that. Yeah.
Okay, lucky last one to Encik Nubhan, please. Thank you.
Okay, this question is quite tricky.
Non-compliant.
For non-compliance, currently we take legal action. If we detect any non-compliance, we just do a police report and bring the case to the court, and they pay the penalty. That's all.
If it is due to greed, exploitative, and heartlessness, so how? So this is the question.
The thing is that if the parties don't declare to the authority doesn't know. So if it's greed, if you don't mind me answering this, say they are greedy, cost is very high, they're trying to cut cost and stuff like that, it's not sustainable. You might escape one or two times, but definitely these highly reactive cargo is going to blow up and cause an incident. So penny-wise, pound foolish, if they're trying to be greedy, generally.
Not only that, Reshma. Once that cargo crosses the ship's railing, now everything now is on the hands of the carrier. So if something happens during the voyage and it results in not only damage to the vessel itself, but if it results in loss of life of the seafarers and all that, then that's going to be on their hands, on this particular party's hands.
They have to get ready to go to Hague, right?
Yeah, all right.
Yes, I believe if we... it can be the whole day discussion, if in case that, you know, we are talking about the perspective of 3D and so on, yeah. But anyway, I need to proceed with the session. For the last session, we are going to invite the last session will be the closing speech by Yang Berbahagia Datuk Muhammad Muhiyuddin Haji Abdullah, the CLLB President. So I would like to welcome Datuk for a closing remark.
Thank you. So bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and very good afternoon. Distinguished panel of speakers and Puan Zaharah, moderator, Yang Bahagia Datuk Isham, Secretary General of the Ministry of Transport. On behalf of the CLTM, I would like to thank all eminent panel of speakers. We have shared your insights and experiences at this webinar organized by CILTM and MITRANS UITM on the topic and awareness on shipping dangerous goods by sea. CILTM started to provide the competency in logistics and transport professionals and decades of promoting and encouraging the art and science in logistics and transport through professional qualifications to stay relevant. The Chartered Institute of Logistics and Transport in Malaysia at its beginnings in 1965 with the formation of Malaysia section internationally. Internationally, the institute has about 40,000 members, with about half the number residing outside the UK, mostly in the Commonwealth countries. Malaysia has about 2,423 active members of all backgrounds. We are the leading global membership organization for everyone who works in supply chain, logistics, and transport. We are now in over 35 countries worldwide. Our standards and membership status are recognized in member countries. We participated and contributed government policy making in many areas. A career partner for life, we start with students and support their careers all the way to becoming professors, government ministers, and supply chain directors. We are working to build influence with government and state organizations while ensuring we remain open and inclusive, ready to listen and to understand differences, ready to engage locally as well as globally. The international shipping industry is responsible for the carriage of around 90% of world trade, so the safety of vessels is very critical. By 2021, there are about 1,500% increase in container carrying capacity. In 50 years, there are more than 18,000 containers on the Evergreen during the Suez Canal blockade. To safeguard the dangerous cargo transported by sea, the UN introduced the International Maritime Dangerous Goods, or IMDG code, which was adopted in 1955. I think this code, MDG, IMDG code, the SOLAS and MARPOL, I think Captain Kenneth has already elaborated very detail. I think elaborate very clearly. So the regulations regarding vessel carriage of dangerous goods contained in the IMDG code are more stringent than other modes of transportation because the quantities and overall volume carried out are comparatively few. These large quantities, coupled with the challenges of responding to a catastrophic incident at sea, pose increasing risk to sea-going vessels, their crews, and the marine environment. The IMDG code provides strict and specific requirements to shippers in preparing and communicating their dangerous goods shipments, as well as to vessels operators in the safe loading and transport of this and of those goods. Proper IMDG training is necessary to navigate and implement this requirement. Just in the shore-based side, the CILTM as an industry lead body for dangerous for logistics domain will focus on the dangerous cargo training for dangerous cargo handler in Malaysia by developing the event module to be offered to people that handle dangerous cargo in the industry. At present, the reach of the IMDG code extends to about 150 countries around the world, with around 98% ships following the requirements of the code. On a separate note, I believe that the excellence of an educational institution is also measured by the qualities of its trainers and the module offered. Later today, I'm proud to mention that CILTM under Education Committee has developed a CILTM education and training framework and comprehensive training module to reskill and upskill the workers towards competent human capital in this sector. Apart from that, CILTM has fought strong ties with several partners in order to produce more competent human capital that meet the demand of the industry. These initiatives are all reciprocated with CILTM mission to be
I hope Datuk is okay.
I think maybe he's having a problem with his connection.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think so.
So
what's next?
Then again, I would like to personally thank to the respective panel of speakers for taking part in the forum, and the special thanks to the Director General of the Ministry of Transport, has been very supportive of CILTM to be able for CILTM to be the industry lead body for Ministry of Transport, and also recommending to the Ministry of Human Resources to be the industry lead body for the JPK. So, all in all, I would like to personally, I hope that this sector will continue to flourish through the smart partnership. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. President. And great, thank you very much, everyone. And especially, special thanks to Dato' KSU. And I can see that there are still screen from Dato' KSU office here. Thank you very much, Dato'. Dato' President as well, all the panelists, and not to forget to all participants who are still with us now, but 172 out of 400, if not mistaken, registered. Yeah. So thank you very much once again for joining us until now, and we will see you.